these remains of the major events discussed in the Bible. Physical remains, chemical remains, and things that you and I can see, feel, test, and in the case of Sodom and Gomorrah and its sulfur, even taste. These things have been preserved by divine power to a point in time when by satellite TV relay systems and the ability to translate everything of interest into most everyone's language, these things can be shown to the inhabitants of the earth. Now then, we are told in the last book of the Bible, in the last chapter of that book, that there will be those that love and make lies. The world is full of those people today, so you and I must be very careful what we accept as truth. We need to look at these things that you're about to see very carefully and prayerfully, and then we may need to make a decision about our relationship with God. When Paul talked to Felix, it says, and Felix trembled. And then when he talked to another one of the Roman rulers, he says, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. So what we need to do today is to ignore all of those who are inspired by Satan to make you and I believe that there is no reason for us to be in a hurry to make our relationship with God sure. We need to ignore these because life is uncertain. You and I have no guarantee that we will be alive tomorrow. But friend, if we only serve God to avoid the punishment of the wicked or to have an eternal life, then we have missed the whole point, because God loves us. He has demonstrated that in so many ways. And we need to arrive at a point in our relationship with Him that we can say, as Paul said, the love of God constraineth me.
At a time when many on this planet are in despair, and governments look for solutions to the great problems of mankind, a series of discoveries have been brought forward to encourage us that there is still hope for our world, that God has indeed interceded in human history in the past, and that at the proper time, He will do so again. In 1978, Ron Wyatt took his two sons and traveled to a site at the Gulf of Aqaba on the Sinai Peninsula, where he believed the children of Israel crossed the Red Sea in their flight from Egypt. His belief was based on a close reading of the Exodus account in the Bible, as well as several non-biblical historical texts that indicated that the children of Israel traveled along a route leading toward the Promised Land until they turned south into a dried-up riverbed that led them to a beach at the Gulf of Aqaba. Following the biblical text, Ron and his sons traveled to the southern end of the beach at Nueva on the Gulf of Aqaba, where they found a Phoenician-style column lying on the beach, partially covered with sand. It looked similar to columns Ron had seen in Israel. If there were any inscriptions on the column, they'd been eroded away by the water. But in 1984, Iran found a similar column standing on the beach in Saudi Arabia opposite this site. After showing this column to the Saudi authorities, they removed it, and this marker was erected in its place. At the present time, we are unsure of its whereabouts. Inscriptions on this column were still intact. Ran was able to translate the words Mizraim, Death, Edom, Yahweh, Pharaoh, and Solomon. Based on this and the fact that history records that King Solomon had a fleet of ships in this area of the Red Sea, he believed that this column was erected by Solomon to commemorate God's miraculous deliverance of the children of Israel. Since the Sinai Peninsula was under Israeli control at this time, Ran showed the column to some Israeli soldiers who were building a patrol road near the beach. Soon after that, the Israelis moved the column up the hill and across the road and set it in concrete, where it remains until this day. While on their first dive at the site, they found a number of artifacts that were later shown to be coral-encrusted chariot parts, such as these. They found numerous samples of these chariot remains, including 4, 6, and 8-spoked wheels. Since that first dive, other artifacts have been found at this site. Here are 2 chariot wheels, with 1 wheel buried in the sand, and the axle and a portion of the other wheel protruding into the air. Here is a 6-spoked wheel with one of the spokes broken off. These are the remains of an 8-spoked wheel. When these formations were scanned with a metal detector, they received positive readings for iron. In a number of places, they found broken pieces of coral that contained rust stains, including this piece of a chariot wheel spoke found by Jonathan Gray. Notice that the inner core clearly contains iron. Horse and human skeletal remains have also been found in the sand, as well as those covered with coral. But the most amazing find was this 4-spoked, gold-covered chariot wheel. Ron was able to video the find, but was not able to recover the piece, as the underlying wood or metal structure had disintegrated over the centuries, and had left only a thin shell. Any attempt to remove it would have destroyed the artifact. Therefore, Ron chose to leave the wheel in place. There was only one period in Egyptian history when 4, 6, and 8-spoke chariot wheels were used concurrently, and this was during the 18th dynasty. This is the time period in which many scholars believe the Hebrew Exodus took place. There were 3 specific points that led Ron to believe this might be the site where the Red Sea crossing took place. First, the Bible says that the Israelites were out of Egypt when they journeyed to the Red Sea. This means that they had to be east of the Gulf of Suez, which would place them in the Sinai Peninsula. From that point, the only water left for them to cross was at the Gulf of Aqaba. Second, there is only one place on the western shore of the Gulf of Aqaba that has a beach area large enough to hold the 2 to 3 million people that were traveling this route. It is the beach at Nuweiba, and it is so large that it can be easily seen in satellite photos. Third, when Ron studied the current bathymetric maps of this area, they indicated that there was a clear, shallow pathway that led from this beach to the opposite shore. Both to the north and to the south of this pathway, the sea floor plunged to over 1 mile deep. But at this site, there was a smooth pathway that was over 1 mile wide that sloped at a gentle 6-degree angle. When Ron and his sons dove at this site, up to 1.5 miles out, they could see this gently sloping pathway, and that it led toward the opposite shore in Saudi Arabia. Since Ron's initial dives at this site, a number of his associates and other scientists have confirmed his findings. Electronic equipment and underwater robot cameras have been used to record the area and document a number of artifacts. The distance across the sea at this point is about 8 to 9 miles. The slope of the seafloor has been measured to average 6 degrees, which is the approximate angle approved for handicap ramps in the United States. In 2000 and 2001, Dr. Lennart Möller of the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm, Sweden, conducted a series of dives in this area, and now concurs with most of Ron's findings. He's published both a book and a video on the subject, which are currently available. With Ron's finding of chariot parts in the Gulf of Aqaba and the other evidence that pointed to this being the crossing site, it became clear that Mount Sinai, which is where Moses had been instructed to take the people, was in Saudi Arabian territory. The late editor of the National Geographic magazine once stated, "If the Ark of Noah is ever discovered, it will be the greatest archaeological find in human history." On June 20, 1987, the Turkish government announced to the world the discovery of the remains of Noah's Ark, based on 10 years of intensive research by Ron Wyatt of Nashville, Tennessee. They commissioned the building of a visitor center overlooking the remains and set aside the immediate area as a national park. Ron was invited as the guest of honor at the dedication ceremony, which was attended by numerous Turkish government and military dignitaries. In 1959, during a NATO aerial photographic mission, a Turkish army captain photographed an unusual boat-shaped object located 12 miles south of Mount Ararat. It appeared to be the approximate size of the biblical ark. These pictures, along with an article on the subject, were published in the September 1960 issue of Life magazine. After studying these photos, photogrammetry expert Dr. Arthur Brandenberger stated, "I have no doubt at all that this object is a ship. In my entire career, I've never seen an object like this on a stereo photo." 17 years later, in 1977, Ron Wyatt made his first trip to this area to specifically look for this formation. During that trip, he and his two sons not only found the boat-shaped formation, but also several huge drug-style anchor stones that they believed were associated with the Ark. These stones appeared to be aligned along the path the Ark might have taken as it came to rest in this part of eastern Turkey. On these stones, he found several iconographic inscriptions which he believed represent the 8 survivors of the flood. Ron explains,
"Like all the other grave markers in this area, the Valley of the Eight, this marker once had 8 crosses. Now these are beautiful representation of the ornate Byzantine cross dating back to approximately the 3rd century AD. The large cross representing Noah is especially ornate. The one representing his wife is quite a beautiful design. Now we have the matched pairing here, the eldest son and his wife. These crosses are of the ornate style. We have this cross here that represents one of the sons beyond the first son, and it matches with this one. Up here we have the representation of the other son, but the representation or the cross representing his wife is missing and apparently got broken away over the years."
In 1978, an earthquake in this region caused the earth to drop away from the formation, exposing rib timbers and deck support timbers along the sides. Ron was able to take samples of the petrified wood and the soil around them. On analysis, the samples were found to contain a higher than normal level of organic carbon, indicating that this was indeed once a wooden object. In the 1980s, with the cooperation of the Turkish government, Ron and his team were able to do several metal detection surveys, which revealed that the timbers were held together with metal rivets and plates.
Our last trip out there this past June, we found this very impressive rivet. And if you'll notice here, the plate itself is just a little more than 1/4 inch in thickness. It's approximately 3.5 inches in diameter, the plate itself, and then the shaft of the rivet is roughly 1 to 1.25 inches in diameter. And if you'll notice here, it was struck while it was hot and flared out the end of the shaft so that it would not slide back through the hole in this washer. And this shows that their abilities to use metal was quite advanced, quite sophisticated. And folks, there are thousands of these rivets on this boat. In fact, at every joint where the wooden structures are held together, they're held together by large metal plates, which are predominantly iron, and then these rivets.
Ground-penetrating radar scans of the formation revealed a huge man-made structure beneath the surface of the formation, which included keels, decks, bulkheads, and all the other parts of an ancient boat. It was during one of these scans that one located just below the surface what ended up to be a large piece of a petrified deck timber. On examination, it was seen that it was laminated, that is, it was made up of three separate layers of wood, as you can see in this view.
Do you believe Noah's Ark actually existed? Could the legend that sounds like a fairy tale really become proven fact? Well, the search has been going on since biblical times. And in a moment, you're going to meet some people who are positive they have found the Ark. Now, we know such claims have been made before. But a few months ago, these people came to 2020 with some new and intriguing scientific findings. We followed them to the mountains of eastern Turkey. And what you'll see is a bizarre adventure with a host of unlikely characters. Tom Gerald's story takes many twists and turns.
That's the seductive beauty that brings them here, snow-capped Mount Ararat. The explorers looked for the Ark there since that's the highest point around here. And as the floodwaters receded, presumably that's where it would have landed. But the Bible describes the mountains of Ararat, mountains plural. Is it possible that the Ark came to rest on one of the smaller sister mountains to Ararat?
The boat-shaped site was first found and photographed by a Turkish army captain back in 1959. It was quickly explored and dismissed as a freak of nature. But Wyatt, an amateur archaeologist, rekindled interest in it a few years ago. He brought in Dave Fassel, a marine salvage expert, to assess it. The Doomsday Mountain team brought in some high technology to explore the oldest legend of man. They began scanning their site with a molecular frequency generator. It's a device used by surgeons to pinpoint cancer tumors, and it's been used by Fassel to locate underwater treasure. This time, the molecular frequency generator began to pick up a unique pattern of iron lines beneath the earth.
Okay, bring that one up.
They began placing ribbons along those lines. The finished shape, outlined by the ribbons, was that of a huge ship, the approximate length and width of Noah's Ark, as described in the Bible. The fascinating field of ribbons soon attracted higher academic interest.
That looks like iron. Okay.
Dr. John Baumgartner, a physicist with Los Alamos Laboratories, sent samples back to the lab for analysis and confirmed that the metal they were tracing with the ribbons was indeed iron. With the width and the length known, the only remaining question was depth. By locating the depth of the hull, they could determine if the boat-shaped object had the cargo capacity described in the biblical ark. To resolve this final issue, Wyatt and Fassel brought geologist Tom Finner to Turkey with his company's heavy-duty subsurface radar equipment. Gear like this located the black box cockpit recorder on the floor of the frozen Potomac River after the Air Florida crash.
Suppose this rock were a foot or 2 feet underground. Would it give you a reading as to where that was? Could you locate it?
Yes, we could.
Is it possible that there will be a moment at which you'll say, this is a man-made object?
The symmetry of the feature suggests it's a boat. I hope to prove that the underground structure is in fact that of a boat.
It was here, several miles short of the boat-shaped site, that a waiting game began for Fenner and the others. The party needed a final go-ahead from the Turkish government to complete their probe of Doomsday Mountain.
Anyway, we're going to hang in like smell on a skunk till the happen layup. Get this done.
And then, like the smell on the sky. The Turkish government stopped the exploration. What now?
Since we were there, Barbara, things have cooled down, and they've sent their own team of scientists in to take a look at this site. It's a very fascinating location.
In August 1985, he receives the necessary permits and clearance to perform the radar examinations. At long last, they perform the scan, and the results are stunning. Before Before their very eyes, the machine tells the story of what lies beneath the surface of the object. There are massive keelsons, deck timbers, open chambers, gunnels, and other various configurations which Ron and other specialists believe identifies the object as the remains of an ancient man-made ship.
Indeed, there is something beneath that rock besides rock. A radar device developed by Geophysical Survey Systems in Hudson was used on the mountain. The device called SIR is used by energy exploration companies to analyze what's below the Earth's surface. According to SIR, something man-made is under Mount Arredog.
This data does not represent natural geology. It's a man-made structure. These reflections are occurring very periodic, too periodic to be random natural type interfaces.
Since Ron's initial work, a number of other artifacts have been found by himself and various others who have worked at the site. As to the anchor stones, 13 in total have been found. Each is approximately the same size, although some of them have been broken over the years. Each has the very distinctive rope hole at the top. Most have crosses carved on them, although two of the stones have been found with no inscriptions whatsoever. Numerous pieces of petrified wood have been found in and around the site, such as these samples. In 1998, while surveying the site with other scientists, Dr. William Shea of the Biblical Research Institute found a pottery shard about 10 meters from the western side of the formation. On one side is painted the picture of a man releasing two birds. On the other side is etched a picture of a man with a hammer in his hand driving a spike or nail. Is wearing some type of a headdress. Across the front of the headdress, the name Noah is written in Proto-Sinaitic text. This is the first piece of hard evidence that directly ties any ark site to the biblical character Noah.
What we actually have found is physical evidence that this is a boat. Whether or not it's Noah's Ark is up to the people that review the material. That's up to them to decide on that. My personal feeling is that it is Noah's Ark.
Since Ron's death in August 1999, several of his associates have continued his work. In February 2000, the political situation in eastern Turkey improved dramatically. Since that time, it has been possible to work in relative safety in the area. A number of other objects and inscriptions have been recently found that are believed to be associated with the Ark. These are currently being analyzed. In Egypt, on the Gulf of Aqaba, Ron gazed across the water with anguish for many years. Based on his finding of chariot remains at Nuweiba, he knew in 1978 that Mount Sinai was in Saudi Arabia. Mount Sinai, the place where the law of God was given, written by God's own finger on tables of stone. After viewing maps of this part of Saudi Arabia, Ron felt that a mountain named Jebel al-Laz was the most likely candidate to be the true Mount Sinai. Over the next 5 years, Ron applied for a visa to enter Saudi Arabia, but was turned down time and time again. Finally, in 1984, Ron and his two sons traveled to Jordan.
slipped across the Saudi border, and traveled to the site to search for evidence. They found the mountain along with numerous pieces of evidence indicating that Ron's belief was accurate. Jebel Allah's was the mountain of God mentioned in the book of Exodus. They took video and photographs of this evidence and prepared to leave Saudi through Jordan the same way they entered. But just short of the border, they were spotted by Saudi authorities and arrested. It took 78 days for them to convince the Saudis that they were just American explorers and not Israeli spies. They were then released, but all of their film and videotape was confiscated.
Three weary Americans came home Monday night. Ronald Wyatt and his sons Daniel and Ronald Jr. returned in Nashville at the end of an amateur archaeology expedition that landed them in a Saudi Arabian jail. They entered Saudi Arabia illegally, searching for the site of the biblical Mount Sinai. Ronald Wyatt and his sons are with us in the studios of our Nashville affiliate WTVF to tell us all about it. Gentlemen, good morning.
Morning. Good morning.
Mr. Wyatt, you there in the middle, yes. Your sons on either side. Why did you, I didn't know that Mount Sinai was in Saudi Arabian territory. Why did you think it was?
We found some chariot parts that looked like the chariots found in King Tut's tomb in the Gulf of Aqaba, west of this Jebel al-Lahz. We found these at depths from 60 feet out to 200 feet and over a stretch of about a mile and a half. And we believe that that was the crossing site. And so in the biblical narrative, they arrived at Mount Sinai after crossing the Red Sea. The language in the Bible indicates that they stayed in a mountain, enclosed in a mountain. So an aerial map showed that this Jebel al-Lahz had a large valley enclosed in the rim of an ancient volcano. It was about 5,000 acres in there. We felt this was the place. And in Exodus 24:4 and in Leviticus 6:28, 11:33, and 15:12, it tells of some artifacts that were to be found. There was to be 12 pillars of stone and an altar and some pottery. And so this is why we looked at that particular mountain.
It was not until 1992 that Ron Wyatt was able to find someone that lived in Saudi to go to the site and document it again for him. Now we can see this majestic mountain where God's own presence rested. Jebel al-Lahz in northwest Saudi Arabia. Here's the documentation of the evidence Ron first saw in 1984. In Galatians chapter 4, verse 25, the Apostle Paul tells us, "For this agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia." Exodus chapter 19, verse 18, "And Mount Sinai was altogether on a smoke, because the Lord descended upon it in fire." Could this blackened peak be the result of the consuming fire of God's own presence resting upon it? In 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 8 and 9, we read how Elijah came to Horeb, that is Mount Sinai, and went into a cave. Here we see a very large cave just below the solitary tree, which is several hundred feet below the blackened peak. As we view the precinct, the area at the foot of the mountain, we can see a large fence and a guardhouse, which was erected immediately after Ron showed this site to a Saudi archaeologist in 1985. This fence follows along the lines of the remains of boundary markers, which God directed Moses to erect. The sign by the guardhouse states that this is an archaeological site passed by royal decree, and that it is unlawful to trespass, subject to penalty. As we pan to the left, here we can see where the fence ends on the other side. And now, as we pan away from the holy precinct, we look out into the area of the camp of the Israelites. There are several archaeological remains still here, but this one is of particular interest for us. In Exodus chapter 32, we read of the golden calf and how Aaron fashioned it. Verse 5 says, "And when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made proclamation and said, 'Tomorrow is a feast to the Lord.' There's little doubt that these are the remains of that very altar that Aaron built to the golden calf. When the Saudi archaeologist from Riyadh University, who went there with Ron in 1985, saw this, he was very excited. The 12 petroglyphs of cows and bulls captured his interest because they are found nowhere else in Saudi Arabia. The style of their horns and bodies is distinctly ancient Egyptian, the same style found in the temples and tombs of ancient Egypt. Unable to enter the holy precinct from the front and climb upon Mount Sinai, we now approach it from the backside. Climbing the mountain here, we soon find ourselves on top of a large, sheltered plateau. Here we have a better view of the blackened peak. Panning the area, we find it can easily be large enough to accommodate the 70 elders who accompanied Moses up into the mountain at one point in time. And just ahead, over that ledge, lies the holy precinct. Looking down, we see the fence, which follows along the bounds set by Moses. And just beyond that fence is a part of the camp of the Israelites. Zooming in closer to the holy precinct, we can see the remains of an ancient foundation. Could this be part of the remains of the altar God instructed Moses to build? Exodus chapter 20, verse 25 says, "And if thou wilt make me an altar of stone, thou shalt not build it of hewn stone." Panning further, we stopped to look at the tracks made by the Bedouin's trucks before the fence was erected. This gives a good perspective of the enormity of the area. And here we see the guard building and archaeological sign, which we saw earlier from the front. Returning to the altar we saw earlier, the camera begins to pan outward, where we will be able to see the location of the altar to the golden calf. Exodus chapter 32, verse 19 says, "And it came to pass, as soon as he came nigh unto the camp, that he saw the calf and the dancing. And Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tables out of his hands and broke them beneath the mount." Still visible today also is an erosion pattern, which may signify the path where water descended from the mountain to give the people abundant water for themselves and their flocks and herds. Preparing to leave, we can look down upon the backside of the mountain and again see the vast plain area. Arriving on the opposite side of this mountain, we find an area which fits the biblical description of Rephidim, the last encampment of the Israelites before they reached Mount Sinai. In Exodus chapter 17, verse 6, the Lord tells Moses, "Behold, I will stand before thee upon the rock in Horeb, and thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it, that the people may drink." And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. The most incredible evidence for this site is the giant split boulder upon a hill, with evidence that large streams of water flowed from it at one time. The rocks still display the erosion pattern of tremendous amounts of water descending from this rock. As we travel through the split in the boulder, we soon can see the channels cut in the rock from the water flow on the other side. Panning outward, we can see these channels continue out into the plain. After the battle, when Israel had defeated the Amalekites, the Bible tells us that Moses did something. In Exodus chapter 17, verse 15, we read, "And Moses built an altar and called the name of it Jehovah Nissi." Here are the remains of a very ancient altar, part of it fallen, perhaps because of an earthquake or Bedouins looking for treasure inside. Enough is still intact, however, to show it was indeed an altar, as it is not hollow inside, but solid all the way through. Backtracking along the path the Israelites took from the Red Sea, we can just barely make out the Gulf of Aqaba up ahead. As we continue our approach, the wadi, or canyon, seems to narrow from afar, but now it can be seen to be large enough for the vast multitude to have traveled through. And across the water, we can see the large beach area on the Egyptian side. Just as the beach on the Egyptian side is certainly large enough to accommodate several million people, here we can see that this beach also contains a tremendous plain. In Exodus chapter 14, verse 30, we read, "Thus the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead upon the seashore." In 1984, when Ron and his sons were imprisoned here in Saudi, Ron directed his captors to this beach in a helicopter, where he showed them a Phoenician-style column with inscriptions in archaic Hebrew, indicating that King Solomon had erected this column in honor of Yahweh to commemorate the crossing of the Red Sea on dry land. Today, all that remains there is this marker noting the location of that column. And while we do not know where they have taken it, we feel sure that it is protected and will be located soon. As we look towards the Gulf, we can see the end of the tongue of the underwater land bridge, and that it leads across to this very beach, just beyond where the column once rested. Panning the beach, we also see the restored remains of the ancient fortress we believe to be Baal Zephon of the biblical account.
In 1979, Ron Wyatt was actively involved in projects associated with the Ark of the Covenant, Mount Sinai in Saudi Arabia, and scuba diving at a site he believed was the place where the Hebrews of the biblical Exodus crossed the Red Sea on dry land. To get to this diving site, he would fly into the airport in Israel and travel by car along the Dead Sea Coast Road down to the Red Sea coast. Over the next 10 years, Ron traveled up and down this road numerous times, but in 1989 he was suddenly impressed to stop and examine some odd-shaped, whitish formations along the western shore of the Dead Sea. Despite having driven past these sites all these years, he now noticed that they looked like the shapes of city walls and buildings. Could these be the remains of Sodom and Gomorrah? On examination, he found that the material which made up these formations was soft and would crumble in your hands, as you can see here. Ron took samples and then went on to his original destination. The next year, in August 1990, he returned to more closely inspect these areas. He soon discovered that there were five sites in this area that were separate and distinct from each other. Their locations stretched north to south, from a few miles north of the Dead Sea, down the western coast to the southern end of the shoreline. The Bible tells us in Genesis 19 that God destroyed the cities of the plain with brimstone and fire, which is sulfur. Upon examination, there was found to be all the aspects of an ancient city. However, everything was in the form of ash. This ash was made up of calcium carbonate and calcium sulfate. Since the predominant stone in this area is limestone-based, this is exactly what you would expect to find if limestone was burned in the presence of sulfur. The site he chose to examine was adjacent to the mountain fortress of Masada. Based on his research, he believed that this site was probably the location of the city referred to as Gomorrah. Ron noticed that the ash was in very fine layers. This is consistent with materials that have been burned at extremely high temperatures, temperatures of up to 4 to 5,000 degrees. When materials are burned at extremely high temperatures, they're not consumed in the normal fashion. The molecules of the various substances become ionized and separate out according to their positive or negative charge. The term for this is thermal ionization. This process caused the layering effect. Most of the formations Ron saw were unrecognizable, as they had collapsed in upon themselves over the centuries. But the solid structures, such as walls, statues, and worship symbols, were in a remarkably good state of preservation. Ron was able to locate the outer wall of the city, and following this, he soon found himself looking into the main part of Gomorrah. But before he entered in, he noticed on a high prominence, about 100 meters from what appeared to be the gate of the city, an amazingly distinct formation. It clearly bore the shape of a sphinx. The location of this formation is significant because it was a practice of the Canaanite people of this period to place statues of their gods outside of their cities as a form of protection.
Welcome. We're here at the site of what we believe is Gomorrah near the Dead Sea, and just a little further south from here is Masada. But we found this very distinct formation up on a raised area right outside this city wall here. And I wanted to show you a few distinct features about it. Other than the fact that it stands out from everything else and is sitting outside the city wall, it's made from ash. You see it just crumbles when I rub it with my finger.
Keep doing that, Bill.
You can see the layering in this formation. And this is all ash. It's just... But notice also the coloring is it's white towards the bottom, and as you go to the top, it gets darker. Also, if you look across the bottom here, you can see that this formation is not even a part of what we're standing on. There's actually a built-up platform right here, and then this was actually at some point sat on top of it. So there's no way that this could have been formed by water runoff or sedimentation. This is not a natural formation, it's a man-made formation of some type. And if you walk around the thing, you can see that it has very much of a body, a neck, and a head, although the details of the features have worn off over the centuries. But it's still a very distinctive feature, and it was quite common in these Canaanite cities for them to place their deities and worship figures outside the city as a form of protection.
Within the city, Ron also found this amazing structure, which appears to be the remains of a very large building, perhaps a palace. It is about 50 feet in height and was found to have a moat completely surrounding it. Notice the definite roofline and the squared corners that still remain. Adjacent to the city was a raised platform with three formations on it. When viewed from the top of Masada, it appeared to resemble a worship complex. It is one of the highest areas within the city, and this is consistent with these ancient people placing their worship areas on a raised platform. A building that was probably the remains of a temple is the largest formation on the platform. There's also a definite sphinx-shaped formation that is about 25 feet in height. The last formation resembles a ziggurat, that is a step pyramid, which is about 30 feet in height. Compare this to a similar pyramid found in Egypt near Cairo.
So what we're looking at is we're at this area in what we believe is Gomorrah. And we found this ashen remains of some kind of building. We're not sure what it is, and we were wondering how we could prove that it was a building. Here we see two stones. 99% of this is ash, but we found these two stones that have been burnt and have probably fallen from a higher part of this building. And this proves that at one point this building was made from stone. Now, the way you can tell it's burnt is if you look right here, when this stone fell, it chipped or broke. And here you can see a burn ring right here in the stone, and here you see the lighter actual color of the rock before it was burned, because this was broken off and wasn't burned. So here we see more evidence of the fact that this building was once made of stone but now is ash, and that it was burnt at very high temperatures.
While searching for conclusive proof that would convince others that these were the remains of the cities of the plain, Ron began to find round balls of a yellow material within the ash that had the smell of sulfur. Could this be the brimstone mentioned in the Bible story? He found this sulfur everywhere and collected numerous samples. Once back in the United States, Ron took these samples to Galbraith Labs in Knoxville, Tennessee. It was found that this material was not only sulfur, but it was quite unique. Any good book on geology will tell you that native sulfur, that is, sulfur as it appears in nature, is always found in crystalline form. The purity varies from 40 to 60%. Samples from Ron's sites have tested up to 98% in purity, and they're not in crystalline form, but in a powdered form. Many of the samples have reddish-brown rings around the perimeter. This is a sulfur compound that is formed when burning molten sulfur is cooled very quickly. This is evidence that these samples were once on fire. We have since shown this sulfur to experts, and they all agree that they are completely unique. In fact, Stetson University near Orlando, Florida, which owns the second largest privately held mineral collection in the world, asked us to donate a sample to them because they had no specimen like it at all. A chief geologist at Virginia Tech University stated that he had never seen sulfur so finely grained. When he showed it to a colleague and told him the sample came from the Dead Sea area, the other geologist commented, "Could this be the fiery brimstone from the Holy Land?" Ron explains.
Now, the Bible tells us that it rained fire and brimstone upon the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, what you see in front of you here is the results of large and small, well, varying sized chunks of sulfur, burning sulfur, that have hit. And what we find here is that God rained this burning sulfur down upon this city, and rain is a perfect description of it. It landed just in the pattern that rain would fall. And the stuff, of course, the accumulative heat of all of this upon the city set the entire thing ablaze. The flashpoint of every material there, metal, stone, of course the people, and everything burned. And this sulfur continued to burn, and it vitrified the material around it. After it had burned it all up, sealed itself off from the oxygen, and then of course smothered itself out. And in each of these little crystalline capsules here is a varying size chunk of sulfur. And there are millions of these in these ashes that we have here. Now, some of them we have cracked open so you can see the sulfur inside, and others we have left intact. But there are millions of these here. So this shows that God indeed rained fire and brimstone upon these cities. And if you'll look in your dictionary, under brimstone, you'll find that it is sulfur.
Ron decided to see what would happen when this sulfur was ignited. He performed his own small test at home with some of the sulfur from one of the capsules and a spoon. The purplish flame is indicative of the intense heat which prevented him from holding the spoon as it burned. He later discovered that his spoon had a hole in it from the fire. Then he placed a small piece of the ash material in a spoon and attempted to burn it, but it wouldn't burn at all. It was already completely consumed by fire, and nothing was left to ignite.
In 1978, while in Jerusalem, Ron Wyatt was walking outside the old city near Calvary Escarpment when he met a man who worked with the Israeli Department of Antiquities. As they walked along discussing Roman antiquities, Ron had an experience that had never happened to him before. His left hand suddenly moved out from his side and pointed to a spot at the base of the escarpment wall. As this happened, he found himself saying, "That's Jeremiah's grotto, and the Ark of the Covenant is in there." Up until this point, Ron had never thought about finding the Ark of the Covenant. He had never researched the subject, much less thought about the possibility of excavating for it. As his mind was reeling, considering the possibility, he was astonished to hear his companion say, "That's wonderful. We'll not only furnish you the permit, we'll put you up in a place to stay, have your laundry done, and furnish your meals." But Ron was perplexed. The only reason he was in Jerusalem was because he had gotten severely sunburned while diving for chariot parts in the Red Sea, and had come back to wait his flight back home. He explained to the man from the Antiquities Department that he was due back at work, so he would have to go home and return later. That would give him time to do some research to figure out whether or not the Ark of the Covenant could even be in that location. Beginning that next year, Ron came back time and time again with his sons, Danny and Ronnie, and dug throughout the cave system under the Calvary Escarpment, having little idea where he was even supposed to look. As they excavated down the escarpment wall in the area where his hand had pointed, they uncovered three cutouts in the cliff face that were consistent with cutouts used by the Romans to hold signs, a rough equivalent to our billboard signs today. The signs detailed the crimes for which the criminals were being executed. Digging down further, they discovered the wall of a first century building that they believed was a church, as it contained an altar. In front of that altar was a 14-inch square hole in the bedrock, with three other similar holes out in front of it. These were the type of holes used to hold crosses upright, a form of Roman execution. The single cross hole was filled with a stone plug and was unusual in that it had a large crack in it. Within the crack was a dark brown substance that looked like dried blood. However, Ron did not understand the significance of this at the time. Finally, in January of 1982, after digging in the cave system for 3 years, Ron discovered a tunnel that led into a chamber, which contained a gold table and several other articles which he believed to be from the First Temple. Then, further back, he saw the top of a stone case that appeared to be the correct size to contain the Ark of the Covenant. In the ceiling of the chamber, directly above the left side of the stone case, Ron noticed a large crack. He also noticed that the top of the stone case was broken, creating an opening in the top of the case. and splashed around that opening in the top was the same brown substance that Ron had seen by the cross hole. Realizing what he had found, Ron, overwhelmed with emotion, passed out and lay in that chamber for 45 minutes. He knew what was in that case, but now what? He attempted to photograph it with a Polaroid camera, a 35mm camera, and video. In every case, the images were wiped out. Ron returned home to work until he could afford to return. In May, he borrowed a colonoscope and went back into the chamber. Drilling a small hole through the case, he was able to see enough to positively identify the contents of the stone case. It was the Ark of the Covenant.
On January 6th, 1982, at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, I broke into a chamber beneath the Calvary Escarpment, north of the city wall of Jerusalem. In that chamber is the Ark of the Covenant, the Table of Showbread, and several other things that I didn't see. They were covered with animal skins, with boards, and then with stones. We had excavated down that escarpment. We had found three cutouts in the wall like a recessed bookcase. We know from the valley north of Jerusalem that the ancient kings and rulers cut these things out in cliffs near populous areas or where a lot of people would be going by, and they put plaques of stone and whatever else in there bearing messages. We found the cutouts. We found the cross holes. If you read in the book of Matthew and the Gospels where it talks about Christ's death, it says the earth shook violently and the rocks were rent. Right to the left of the cross hole at the base of where Christ died on the cross, the rock was rent. After Christ died and the centurion stuck his spear into Christ's spleen and the blood and water came out, it went down through that crack. It went on to the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant that God had arranged to be hidden in that chamber 600 years before Christ died. Now, what is the significance of this? Psalm 77:13 says, "Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary." On the Day of Atonement, the goat that represented Christ as the sin bearer, after all of the sins were figuratively transferred to its head, was killed. Its blood was taken into the most holy place and sprinkled on the mercy seat. Those folks looked forward to the fact that Christ would die. They confessed their sins on the head of lambs and took the lives of these innocent little animals. We, by faith, believe that Christ has indeed died. And we, in praying to God in Christ's name, receive forgiveness of our sins by faith in that fact. North of the city wall in Jerusalem, several feet below the current ground level, rests a perfect explanation and demonstration of the old covenant, the sacrificial system, and the new covenant. You and I are living in the most exciting time in Earth's history. We have an opportunity to blend our voices with the voices of our fellow believers in raising the last warning message to planet Earth. And let me say this, friend, as we happily contemplate the thought of Christ taking us away from this place and that we do not get struck by the seven last plagues, if when you think of those pleasant things and the pleasant prospects for the Christian, if you are not concerned for your neighbors and your family and loved ones and other people's families and loved ones, those for whom Christ died, who are every bit as important to him as you and I are, then you won't be whisked off anywhere. We have to have the same loving, tender heart that Christ has. We cannot feel that we are more important, we're better than others. You can be used gift of God to save souls, and there's no greater privilege and honor that a human being can have than that. So you may not be on the platform tonight, but you're on God's platform, and He wants you to help Him.
In June of 2000, Jerry Bowen and I traveled to eastern Turkey with the expressed intent of exploring and documenting the landing site of Noah's Ark and the artifacts that we believe are associated with it. The remains of Noah's Ark are found exactly where the Bible tells us that they would be located, upon the mountains of Ararat. That location is 12 miles south of the world-famous Mount Ararat, about 5 kilometers off the main road in a mud flow just below the Kurdish village of Uzungeli. But we should be there shortly. This is the road leading up to the visitor center for the Ark. From the visitor center that the Turkish government built for the site in 1987, you can get a good view of the Ark.
Well, there it is, what we came here to see. Noah's Ark. It appears that part of the left side has fallen out. We're going to have to go down and do some exploration on that.
From this vantage point, you can see several of the features of the formation, such as some of the exposed rib timbers that have eroded out over the years. Here is a closer view. Here is another set of exposed rib timbers on the opposite side. One of the tests we performed at the Ark site was a metal detection survey. This was done by Ron Wyatt's team in the 1980s and showed a distinct pattern of metal rivets that were used to hold the beams of the Ark together. In 1991, Ron found one of these rivets that had fallen out of the formation. It contained a high iron content along with several other metals. On this current survey, we found an iron plate embedded in a petrified beam with two visible rivets still in place. This plate and the rivets gave us a positive metal reading for iron.
What'd you find, Jerry?
Oh, just a rock. A little sample there. I'll take it over for somebody. I'd like to find a nice piece of rivet.
You got one right behind you. You can't do anything with it, it's embedded.
Right. I'd like to find one loose.
Over the years, a number of petrified wood specimens have been found. Here is one we located.
Okay, there's the city of Uzungeli. Swing over there, you can see the visitor center. And right at my feet here is a very large piece of petrified timber. You can see the wood grain and everything. I'm going to zoom in so you can see the texture of it. This looks like wood, and it's stone. Look at that grain. Back off a little bit here. It's coming right out of here where I'm right by the limestone outcropping. See that?
Something.
That's petrified wood.
Yeah.
I mean, look at the grain in that thing.
A number of specimens have been found over the years, but none match this 35-pound laminated deck timber. It was found by Ron in 1987 after spotting it with ground-penetrating radar. More specimens like this can be recovered if we are allowed to perform a limited excavation. One of the most unusual items we came across was this large specimen that appears to be a gigantic piece of petrified bark. It also has carved on it an 8-cross iconographic representation of Noah, his wife, their 3 sons, and their wives, the 8 survivors of the flood.
This is a piece of petrified tree bark, or at least that's what it appears to be, right near Soglik Suyu. You can see the grain in it. It's rather impressive. Listen, go see if you can point out some of the crosses.
Looks like the big one is right here.
Okay, speak up because of the wind.
It looks like the big one's right here in the middle.
There's one right down there too.
Over here.
There's one further down on your left, close to you. Further down left, it's hard to see from the lichen growing up in the orange. Lichen? No, it's down. Put your hand on it right there. Down a little bit. No, down towards. No, the other way. Yeah, right in that area. Yeah, I think that's it.
Probably the best known and recognized artifacts that are associated with Noah's Ark are these large drogue anchor stones. They were most likely used to stabilize the Ark in the rough waters of the deluge. Almost everyone recognizes this monster, which has been photographed hundreds of times over the last 15 years. It is 8 feet tall and is estimated to weigh 3 to 4 tons. While having the iconographic of Noah and his family, it also has carved into it 2 signs of Nimrod when he was still alive. These anchor stones, 13 in all, are scattered throughout the area around the village of Kassan. Here are some clips of Jerry and I examining a few of them.
The anchor stone right there. Here's the part of the hole at the top is broken off. Yeah, you can see the crosses. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight.
So you got.
It's all right, go ahead. Point them out.
Looks like you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
And the big one in the middle is 8. Markings on both of them as if it's parts of two. Well, I got you here on tape. Why don't you just give me your impressions? Just, you know, whatever you want to say about the last couple of days out on Noah's Ark and Sidewick Suyu and around the anchor stones. What's your impression?
Certainly an adventure. I mean, something that the average person is not going to be able to experience. It is somewhat awesome to think that you're right at the exact spot where human history began again after the flood, because that's everybody's roots.
That's right. We all come from Father Noah.
Standing right there.
From a few days ago. Are you videotaping this?
I am now.
Okay, good. Okay, what this is it's a stalactite, which is approximately 11 to 12 inches long. And this was the stalactite that was hanging down in front of the chamber, or the entrance into the chamber where Ron first entered and found the Ark of the Covenant. And he broke it off, and you can see where it's broken right here. If you can get that in the proper light.
can see where it's broken off. He broke that off so that the little Arab boy that was with him could get into the chamber. And of course, I believe later, if I remember the story correctly, he had to enlarge the hole a little bit so he could get in. But this is the stalactite from that cave.
Now tell us what this is.
Let me put this away. The seal stone that was in the cross hole that we believe held the cross of Christ. And they used these seal stones to plug the hole when it wasn't being used, so that in between uses, it was left with debris and everything, because then you couldn't get anything in it. And a 12-inch square hole would be very difficult to dig the debris and everything out. It was approximately about 2.5 feet deep. I think it was 28 inches, something like that.
Okay. Do you know which way up it went? Was it this way up, or this way up?
I believe it was like this, and the reason I say that is because you can see the seepage here. It's kind of a concretion where it was sitting like this, and the moisture formed on the bottom.
Okay.
But that's just a speculation on my part. I believe it was
that
like this.
Okay.
And it's approximately 12 inches by 13 inches. It's not quite square. It's a little bit longer this way than it is that way.
And that fit securely in the hole so that the
Yeah, in fact, on the video, you can see it sitting in the hole.
Okay.
I believe in one of the video shots.
So the upright beam for the cross, that's about the rough dimensions it would have been.
Would have been approximately, probably about 12 by 12.
Okay.
This is deck timber that was taken from near the back of Noah's Ark. Ron found this on the radar scan, and they dug it up. It's been tested. It contains organic carbon, which is consistent with what you find in petrified wood. Now, one of the unique things about this, if we can get it in the light just right, this is actually a piece of deck board that's been laminated. There are three separate layers. You see one right here. It's a larger center section, and it's a little darker in color, and then a bottom section here, three different layers. This area right here appears to be a silica replacement of the glue that was used to glue these boards or laminate these boards together, and some of it has seeped out the side. Now, another interesting feature of this deck board is nails.
Oh, okay.
Nail heads. There's one right here. Let me get it into the light and see it a little bit better. And you can experiment with your camera angle. There's one here. And there's one, two, three in a row right here. Some of them are hard to see because they tend to blend in.
So Ron gave you this.
Yeah.
And this is from Noah's Ark.
It is from Noah's Ark.
My shoes in the car.
It's part of an old boat, probably the oldest on the planet.
This first one is a human thumb bone, and it's been identified by radiologists as the second bone of the thumb, this bone right here. As you can see, it's approximately 2.5 times the size of mine, which if you can extrapolate from that, this person was probably somewhere between 11 to 12 feet tall that this bone belonged to. Now, the bone of a child, the epiphysis is still visible here. That's what you find on a bone that is not completely grown, and you find this in children. And as you can see, as I hold it up here, it's just a little bit larger than mine, but mine is full grown. So this was a rather large child. Now this third specimen, unlike the other two, is petrified. And this was found near the Tower of Babel, and it has been identified as a human toe bone, probably from the big toe. And As you can see, it's quite large. It's bigger than any toe. This would just be one of two bones in the toe, so you're talking about a toe that's probably 6 to 7 inches long.
That was a big toe.
That was somebody with a very big foot. What this is a rivet that was found in association with Noah's Ark. What's two remarkable things is you can see the edge of the plate right here where it ends. And you can also see part of the head of the rivet and where, as Ron says, it was struck while it was hot and the hot metal flared out and made it larger than the hole so it wouldn't slide back through the plate. When I was over there in June of 97, Andrew Jones and I found and photographed a whole plate with two rivets in it that had rust stains all around them. Uh-huh. You know, we have that on both photograph and video. And these things are real. They look very, very similar to this. This is a very distinct separation here. Mm-hmm. In fact, I imagine you would still see if you chip some of this matrix material off. But you see it's broken. Here's some broken pieces of it right here, see? Mm-hmm. But we won't attempt to remove those. Okay, this stone that you're looking at here that to me resembles a piece of petrified tree bark. We're told by the locals that it's totally unique. There's nothing else like it in the area. And sometime in antiquity, we don't know how long ago, someone placed 8 crosses on this. We've marked several of them here in white. You can't see them all because a couple of years ago, some vandals came in and defaced it, specifically trying to blot out the crosses. Being a Muslim country, you might understand why they might want to do that. But someone in antiquity not only connected this with Christianity, but by putting 8 crosses on it, it could be interpreted as tying it to the flood story with Noah and the 8 survivors of the flood. When you bang on this rock, you get a hollow sound. Notice how I did that without touching the rock? Yeah.
Did it again, Jeff?
So it's quite unique, especially these longitudinal striations along the top. Several geologists have looked at it, and each one has a different answer. So there's no consensus at this point as to what it is. We've taken samples, and we hope at some point to be able to answer that question, but right now we don't know for sure. But somebody connected this with Christianity and possibly the flood story. Ron Wyatt speculated that this might have been the wooden cover of the ark that Noah threw off when he first stuck his head out of the ark. But we don't know that for sure. That's just speculation.
Obviously, if this is pre-flood, experts examining it today don't have anything to connect it to. If whatever this was doesn't exist anymore.
Well, one thing that Sally Barakatan of Ataturk University said is that this rock is totally out of place. It would be like finding an orange tree in Siberia. It doesn't belong here. It's nothing like it in the area. So, if that's true, then that would tend to suggest that this was brought here from somewhere else. And from the size of it, it's 2.5 to 3 meters long, and about a foot of it was broken off a couple of years ago by the vandals. You would need a truck. Now, I don't think a tractor could even drag this very easily, especially over this rocky, rough terrain.
Now, another question. I understand there's an anchor stone on the ridge up here. The ark is down this way.
There's three ridges. There, and there. There were anchor stones on all three. One has been removed and destroyed. There is on the other two.
Now, okay, the anchor stone's there, the ark's that way. Could it be that it drifted over this way and this was dropped off?
The theory is that it drifted down through this area. And this ridge across here is where the boat became hung up, and Noah cut the anchor stones loose because virtually all of the anchor stones are concentrated in this, in and around this village. Okay, we're here in Soglik Suyu in eastern Turkey. And this is the village that most of the anchor stones are found in or concentrated around. This is one of the best samples of a drogue style anchor. It's remarkable in the fact of its size. As you can see, I'm 5'7", and this thing is significantly higher than me, over 6 feet. Plus, it's probably a couple of feet in the ground to stabilize it. There's the iconographic representation of Noah and his family, and that are put here by probably Byzantine Christians, and then later on other people just copying put other crosses on as well. So there's 18 crosses plus two, one here, one over here, signs of Nimrod. Now, some of the critics have said that these are simply Armenian catch cars, but this is not like an Armenian catch car in a number of ways. First of all, Armenian catch cars are never this large. Any that I've ever seen in this region tend to only be maybe this high and maybe about half as wide, and they always contain Armenian writing on them. This one does not. It simply has the crosses. Also, catch cars do not have the hole in the top. Okay, the hole is significant because this would be how the anchor was attached to the ark. The hole is unique in the fact that it's larger on the outside on both edges and smaller in the center, so a rope could be put through, a knot put in it, and then it pulled through and made secure.
Can you put your hand in the hole there?
Sure. As you can see, it's big enough for me to put my whole fist in. It's approximately 6 inches in diameter on the outside, 6 to 8 inches on the outside, and about 5 on the inside.
How do these compare in scale with other drogue stones?
Well, the drogue stones around the Mediterranean tend to be about maximum about 1 meter high. This one is 2.5 meters, close to 3.
And how many of these have been found?
We've been able to confirm the existence of at least 16. 3 have been destroyed. 13 we, or 11 we know the location of, and 2 we're still looking for.
Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Bill Fry, president of Anchorstone International. I'm standing here just outside of the city of Debizet in eastern Turkey. And behind me is the world-famous Mount Ararat. And I wanted to talk for a moment about a conversation I had with Dr. Sally Baraktatan. He's an assistant professor of geology at Atatürk University. He has a PhD in basin analysis. And his career has been in studying the tectonics and geology of the Ararat region. And he has been very much a supporter and researcher on the Darupinar site, what we believe is the remains of Noah's Ark. And in just talking with him, I asked him one day, I said, we were talking about the mountain people and the people looking for Noah's Ark on Mount Ararat, and I said to him, Sally, tell me what Mount Ararat was like 5,000 years ago at the time of Noah. And he looked at me and he said, well, if it existed at all, it was just a very, very small volcanic dome. It was not the mountain that you see here today, which dominates the landscape of the whole region. What a lot of people don't understand is that there's a growing body of evidence that Mount Ararat is a post-flood mountain, that it did not even exist at the time of Noah. So there is no real reason to look for the ark on that mountain.
So are you saying that this may not have been there after the flood, just after the flood?
That was what Dr. Baraktatan said, and there's also a number of scientists that have collected data that indicate that, yes.
But could you comment upon what the Bible says about this? Wasn't it Mount Ararat that the Ark ended on?
Well, the Bible refers actually to the mountains in a region referred to as Urartu. Urartu was more like a country, and it encompassed this area as well as places west of here. And there's a number of mountain ranges in this area, including the Ararat Range, which is to the north of us, and then there's the Tindrik Range, which is to the south of us. So landing on any of those mountains would meet the criteria given by the Bible that the Ark came to rest upon the mountains of Urartu, or Ararat.
Can you tell us about recent volcanic eruptions on this mountain here?
I don't remember the exact date. Sometime back in the 1800s, there was a very large eruption that blew out the northeast side of the mountain and created what we now know as the Uhura Gorge. This is one of the locations where the mountain people have looked for the Ark and say that they have anecdotal evidence, stories of people saying that they've seen something there. But if you look at a satellite photo of Mount Ararat, you can still see the debris pattern from that explosion. It goes all the way into Armenia. So if the Ark was in that area at the time of that explosion, which it would have been if it landed on the mountain, it would be scattered from here to Armenia.
That means this is not a good candidate.
No, and there's never been any empirical evidence produced from the mountain to indicate that there is a boat up there. There have been several hoaxes, wood taken up there and then later, quote-unquote, discovered, but there's never been any actual evidence found to indicate that there's a boat there.
What about the Ararat anomaly,
the evidence Ron first saw in 1984. In Galatians chapter 4, verse 25, the Apostle Paul tells us, "For this Agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia." Exodus chapter 19, verse 18, "And Mount Sinai was altogether on a smoke, because the Lord descended upon it in fire." Could this blackened peak be the result of the consuming fire of God's own presence resting upon it? In 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 8 and 9, we read how Elijah came to Horeb, that is Mount Sinai, and went into a cave. Here we see a very large cave just below the solitary tree, which is several hundred feet below the blackened peak. As we view the precinct, the area at the foot of the mountain, we can see a large fence and a guardhouse, which was erected immediately after Ron showed this site to a Saudi archaeologist in 1985. This fence follows along the lines of the remains of boundary markers, which God directed Moses to erect. The sign by the guardhouse states that this is an archaeological site passed by royal decree and that it is unlawful to trespass, subject to penalty. As we pan to the left, here we can see where the fence ends on the other side. And now, as we pan away from the holy precinct, we look out into the area of the camp of the Israelites. There are several archaeological remains still here, but this one is of particular interest for us. In Exodus chapter 32, we read of the golden calf and how Aaron fashioned it. Verse 5 says, "And when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made proclamation and said, 'Tomorrow is a feast to the Lord.'" There is little doubt that these are the remains of that very altar that Aaron built to the golden calf. When the Saudi archaeologist from Riyadh University, who went there with Ron in 1985, saw this, he was very excited. The 12 petroglyphs of cows and bulls captured his interest because they are found nowhere else in Saudi Arabia. The style of their horns and bodies is distinctly ancient Egyptian, the same style found in the temples and tombs of ancient Egypt. Unable to enter the holy precinct from the front and climb upon Mount Sinai, we now approach it from the backside. Climbing the mountain here, we soon find ourselves on top of a large, sheltered plateau. Here we have a better view of the blackened peak. Panning the area, we find it can easily be large enough to accommodate the 70 elders who accompanied Moses up into the mountain at one point in time. And just ahead, over that ledge, lies the holy precinct. Looking down, we see the fence, which follows along the bounds set by Moses, and just beyond that fence is a part of the camp of the Israelites. Zooming in closer to the holy precinct, we can see the remains of an ancient foundation. Could this be part of the remains of the altar God instructed Moses to build? Exodus chapter 20, verse 25 says, "And if thou wilt make me an altar of stone, thou shalt not build it of hewn stone."
Panning further, we stopped to look at the tracks made by the Bedouins' trucks before the fence was erected. This gives a good perspective of the enormity of the area. And here we see the guard building and archaeological sign, which we saw earlier from the front. Returning to the altar we saw earlier, the camera begins to pan outward, where we will be able to see the location of the altar to the golden calf. Exodus chapter 32, verse 19 says, "And it came to pass, as soon as he came nigh unto the camp, that he saw the calf and the dancing, and Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tables out of his hands and broke them beneath the mount." Still visible today also is an erosion pattern which may signify the path where water descended from the mountain to give the people abundant water for themselves and their flocks and herds. Preparing to leave, we can look down upon the backside of the mountain and again see the vast plain area. Arriving on the opposite side of this mountain, we find an area which fits the biblical description of Rephidim, the last encampment of the Israelites before they reached Mount Sinai. In Exodus chapter 17, verse 6, the Lord tells Moses, "Behold, I will stand before thee upon the rock in Horeb, and thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it, that the people may drink." And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. The most incredible evidence for this site is the giant split boulder upon a hill, with evidence that large streams of water flowed from it at one time. The rocks still display the erosion pattern of tremendous amounts of water descending from this rock. As we travel through the split in the boulder, we soon can see the channels cut in the rock from the water flow on the other side. Panning outward, we can see these channels continue out into the plain. After the battle, when Israel had defeated the Amalekites, the Bible tells us that Moses did something. In Exodus chapter 17, verse 15, we read, "And Moses built an altar and called the name of it Jehovah Nissi." Here are the remains of a very ancient altar, part of it fallen, perhaps because of an earthquake or Bedouins looking for treasure inside. Enough is still intact, however, to show it was indeed an altar, as it is not hollow inside, but solid all the way through. Backtracking along the path the Israelites took from the Red Sea, we can just barely make out the Gulf of Aqaba up ahead. As we continue our approach, the wadi, or canyon, seems to narrow from afar, but now it can be seen to be large enough for the vast multitude to have traveled through. And across the water, we can see the large beach area on the Egyptian side. Just as the beach on the Egyptian side is certainly large enough to accommodate several million people, here we can see that this beach also contains a tremendous plain. In Exodus chapter 14, verse 30, we read, "Thus the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead upon the seashore." In 1984, when Ron and his sons were imprisoned here in Saudi, Ron directed his captors to this beach in a helicopter, where he showed them a Phoenician-style column with inscriptions in archaic Hebrew, indicating that King Solomon had erected this column in honor of Yahweh to commemorate the crossing of the Red Sea on dry land. Today, all that remains there is this marker noting the location of that column. A and while we do not know where they have taken it, we feel sure that it is protected and will be located soon. As we look towards the Gulf, we can see the end of the tongue of the underwater land bridge, and that it leads across to this very beach, just beyond where the column once rested. Panning the beach, we also see the restored remains of the ancient fortress we believe to be Baal Zephon of the biblical account. In 1979, Ron Wyatt was actively involved in projects associated with the Ark of the Covenant, Mount Sinai in Saudi Arabia, and scuba diving at a site he believed was the place where the Hebrews of the biblical Exodus crossed the Red Sea on dry land. To get to this diving site, he would fly into the airport in Israel and travel by car along the Dead Sea Coast Road down to the Red Sea coast. Over the next 10 years, Ron traveled up and down this road numerous times, but in 1989 he was suddenly impressed to stop and examine some odd-shaped, whitish formations along the western shore of the Dead Sea. Despite having driven past these sites all these years, he now noticed that they looked like the shapes of city walls and buildings. Could these be the remains of Sodom and Gomorrah? On examination, he found that the material which made up these formations was soft and would crumble in your hands, as you can see here. Ron took samples and then went on to his original destination. The next year, in August 1990, he returned to more closely inspect these areas. He soon discovered that there were 5 sites in this area that were separate and distinct from each other. Their locations stretched north to south, from a few miles north of the Dead Sea, down the western coast to the southern end of the shoreline. The Bible tells us in Genesis 19 that God destroyed the cities of the plain with brimstone and fire, which is sulfur. Upon examination, there was found to be all the aspects of an ancient city. However, everything was in the form of ash. This ash was made up of calcium carbonate and calcium sulfate. Since the predominant stone in this area is limestone-based, this is exactly what you would expect to find if limestone was burned in the presence of sulfur. The site he chose to examine was adjacent to the mountain fortress of Masada. Based on his research, he believed that this site was probably the location of the city referred to as Gomorrah. Ron noticed that the ash was in very fine layers. This is consistent with materials that have been burned at extremely high temperatures, temperatures of up to 4 to 5,000 degrees. When materials are burned at extremely high temperatures, they're not consumed in the normal fashion. The molecules of the various substances become ionized and separate out according to their positive or negative charge. The term for this is thermal ionization.
These remains of the major events discussed in the Bible, physical remains, chemical remains, and things that you and I can see, feel, test, and in the case of Sodom and Gomorrah and its sulfur, even taste. These things have been preserved by divine power to a point in time when by satellite, TV, relay systems, and the ability to translate everything of interest into most everyone's language, these things can be shown to the inhabitants of the earth. Now then, we are told in the last book of the Bible, in the last chapter of that book, that there will be those that love and make lies. The world is full of those people today, so you and I must be very careful what we accept as truth. We need to look at these things that you're about to see very carefully and prayerfully, and then we may need to make a decision about our relationship with God. When Paul talked to Felix, it says, and Felix trembled. And then when he talked to another one of the Roman rulers, he says, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. So what we need to do today is to ignore all of those who are inspired by Satan to make you and I believe that there is no reason for us to be in a hurry to make our relationship with God sure. We need to ignore these because life is uncertain. You and I have no guarantee that we will be alive tomorrow. But, friend, if we only serve God to avoid the punishment of the wicked or to have an eternal life, then we have missed the whole point, because God loves us. He has demonstrated that in so many ways. And we need to arrive at a point in our relationship with Him that we can say, as Paul said, the love of God constraineth me.
At a time when many on this planet are in despair, and governments look for solutions to the great problems of mankind, a series of discoveries have been brought forward to encourage us that there is still hope for our world, that God has indeed interceded in human history in the past, and that at the proper time, He will do so again. In 1978, Ron Wyatt took his two sons and traveled to a site at the Gulf of Aqaba on the Sinai Peninsula, where he believed the children of Israel crossed the Red Sea in their flight from Egypt. His belief was based on a close reading of the Exodus account in the Bible, as well as several non-biblical historical texts that indicated that the children of Israel traveled along a route leading toward the Promised Land until they turned south into a dried-up riverbed that led them to a beach at the Gulf of Aqaba. Following the biblical text, Ron and his sons traveled to the southern end of the beach at Nueva on the Gulf of Aqaba, where they found a Phoenician-style column lying on the beach, partially covered with sand. It looked similar to columns Ron had seen in Israel. If there were any inscriptions on the column, they'd been eroded away by the water. But in 1984, Ron found a similar column standing on the beach in Saudi Arabia opposite this site. After showing this column to the Saudi authorities, they removed it, and this marker was erected in its place. At the present time, we are unsure of its whereabouts. Inscriptions on this column were still intact. Ron was able to translate the words Mizraim, Death, Edom, Yahweh, Pharaoh, and Solomon. Based on this and the fact that history records that King Solomon had a fleet of ships in this area of the Red Sea, he believed that this column was erected by Solomon to commemorate God's miraculous deliverance of the children of Israel. Since the Sinai Peninsula was under Israeli control at this time, Ron showed the column to some Israeli soldiers who were building a patrol road near the beach. Soon after that, the Israelis moved the column up the hill and across the road and set it in concrete, where it remains until this day. While on their first dive at the site, they found a number of artifacts that were later shown to be coral-encrusted chariot parts, such as these. They found numerous samples of these chariot remains, including 4, 6, and 8-spoked wheels. Since that first dive, other artifacts have been found at this site. Here are 2 chariot wheels with one wheel buried in the sand, and the axle and a portion of the other wheel protruding into the air. Here is a 6-spoked wheel with one of the spokes broken off. These are the remains of an 8-spoked wheel. When these formations were scanned with a metal detector, they received positive readings for iron. In a number of places, they found broken pieces of coral that contained rust stains, including this piece of a chariot wheel spoke found by Jonathan Gray. Notice that the inner core clearly contains iron. Horse and human skeletal remains have also been found in the sand, as well as those covered with coral. But the most amazing find was this 4-spoked, gold-covered chariot wheel. Ron was able to video the find, but was not able to recover the piece, as the underlying wood or metal structure had disintegrated over the centuries, and had left only a thin shell. Any attempt to remove it would have destroyed the artifact. Therefore, Ron chose to leave the wheel in place. There was only one period in Egyptian history when 4, 6, and 8-spoke chariot wheels were used concurrently, and this was during the 18th dynasty. This is the time period in which many scholars believe the Hebrew Exodus took place. There were 3 specific points that led Ron to believe this might be the site where the Red Sea crossing took place. First, the Bible says that the Israelites were out of Egypt when they journeyed to the Red Sea. This means that they had to be east of the Gulf of Suez, which would place them in the Sinai Peninsula. From that point, the only water left for them to cross was at the Gulf of Aqaba. Second, there's only one place on the western shore of the Gulf of Aqaba that has a beach area large enough to hold the 2 to 3 million people that were traveling this route. It is the beach at Nuweiba, and it is so large that it can be easily seen in satellite photos. Third, when Ron studied the current bathymetric maps of this area, they indicated that there was a clear, shallow pathway that led from this beach to the opposite shore. Both to the north and to the south of this pathway, the sea floor plunged over 1 mile deep. But at this site, there was a smooth pathway that was over 1 mile wide that sloped at a gentle 6-degree angle. When Ron and his sons dove at this site, up to 1.5 miles out, they could see this gently sloping pathway, and that it led toward the opposite shore in Saudi Arabia. Since Ron's initial dives at this site, a number of his associates and other scientists have confirmed his findings. Electronic equipment and underwater robot cameras have been used to record the area and document a number of artifacts. The distance across the sea at this point is about 8 to 9 miles. The slope of the seafloor has been measured to average 6 degrees, which is the approximate angle approved for handicap ramps in the United States. In 2000 and 2001, Dr. Lennart Möller of the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm, Sweden, conducted a series of dives in this area and now concurs with most of Ron's findings. He has published both a book and a video on the subject, which are currently available. With Ron's finding of chariot parts in the Gulf of Aqaba and the other evidence that pointed to this being the crossing site, it became clear that Mount Sinai, which is where Moses had been instructed to take the people, was in Saudi Arabian territory. The late editor of the National Geographic magazine once stated, "If the Ark of Noah is ever discovered, it will be the greatest archaeological find in human history." On June 20, 1987, the Turkish government announced to the world the discovery of the remains of Noah's Ark, based on 10 years of intensive research by Ron Wyatt of Nashville, Tennessee. They commissioned the building of a visitor center overlooking the remains and set aside the immediate area as a national park. Ron was invited as the guest of honor at the dedication ceremony, which was attended by numerous Turkish government and military dignitaries. In 1959, during a NATO aerial photographic mission, a Turkish army captain photographed an unusual boat-shaped object located 12 miles south of Mount Ararat. It appeared to be the approximate size of the biblical ark. These pictures, along with an article on the subject, were published in the September 1960 issue of Life magazine. After studying these photos, photogrammetry expert Dr. Arthur Brandenberger stated, "I have no doubt at all that this object is a ship. In my entire career, I've never seen an object like this on a stereo photo." 17 years later, in 1977, Ron Wyatt made his first trip to this area to specifically look for this formation. During that trip, he and his two sons not only found the boat-shaped formation, but also several huge drug-style anchor stones that they believed were associated with the Ark. These stones appeared to be aligned along the path the Ark might have taken as it came to rest in this part of eastern Turkey. On these stones, he found several iconographic inscriptions which he believed represent the 8 survivors of the flood. Ron explains,
"Like all the other grave markers in this area, the Valley of the Eight, this marker once had 8 crosses. Now these are beautiful representation of the ornate Byzantine cross dating back to approximately the 3rd century AD. The large cross representing Noah is especially ornate. The one representing his wife is quite a beautiful design. Now we have the matched pairing here, the eldest son and his wife. These crosses are of the ornate style. We have this cross here that represents one of the sons beyond the first son, and it matches with this one. Up here we have the representation of the other son, but the representation or the cross representing his wife is missing and apparently got broken away over the years."
In 1978, an earthquake in this region caused the earth to drop away from the formation, exposing rib timbers and deck support timbers along the sides. Ron was able to take samples of the petrified wood and the soil around them. On analysis, the samples were found to contain a higher than normal level of organic carbon, indicating that this was
the case. He was able to see enough to positively identify the contents of the stone case. It was the Ark of the Covenant.
On January 6, 1982, at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, I broke into a chamber beneath the Calvary escarpment, north of the city wall of Jerusalem. In that chamber is the Ark of the Covenant, the table of showbread, and several other things that I didn't see. They were covered with animal skins, with boards, and then with stones. We had excavated down that escarpment. We had found 3 cutouts in the wall like a recessed bookcase. We know from the valley north of Jerusalem that the ancient kings and rulers cut these things out in cliffs near
populous areas are where a lot of people would be going by, and they put plaques of stone and whatever else in there bearing messages. We found the cutouts. We found the cross holes. If you read in the book of Matthew and the Gospels where it talks about Christ's death, it says the earth shook violently and the rocks were rent. Right to the left of the cross hole at the base of where Christ died on the cross, the rock was rent. After Christ died, and the centurion stuck his spear into Christ's spleen and the blood and water came out, it went down through that crack. It went on to the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant that God had arranged to be hidden in that chamber 600 years before Christ died. Now, what is the significance of this? Psalm 77:13 says, "Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary." On the Day of Atonement, the goat that represented Christ as the sin bearer, after all of the sins were figuratively transferred to its head, was killed. Its blood was taken into the most holy place and sprinkled on the mercy seat. Those folks looked forward to the fact that Christ would die. They confessed their sins on the head of lambs and took the lives of these innocent little animals. We, by faith, believe that Christ has indeed died. And we, in praying to God in Christ's name, receive forgiveness of our sins by faith in that fact. North of the city wall in Jerusalem, several feet below the current ground level, rests a perfect explanation and demonstration of the Old Covenant, the sacrificial system, and the New Covenant. You and I are living in the most exciting time in Earth's history. We have an opportunity to blend our voices with the voices of our fellow believers in raising the last warning message to planet Earth. And let me say this, friend, as we happily contemplate the thought of Christ taking us away from this place and that we do not get struck by the seven last plagues, if when you think of those pleasant things and the pleasant prospects for the Christian, if you are not concerned for your neighbors and your family and loved ones and other people's families and loved ones, those for whom Christ died, who are every bit as important to him as you and I are, then you won't be whisked off anywhere. We have to have the same loving, tender heart that Christ has. We cannot feel that we are more important, we're better than others. You can be used of God to save souls, and there's no greater privilege and honor that a human being can have than that. So you may not be on the platform tonight, but you're on God's platform, and he wants you to help him.
In June of 2000, Jerry Bowen and I traveled to eastern Turkey with the expressed intent of exploring and documenting the landing site of Noah's Ark and the artifacts that we believe are associated with it. The remains of Noah's Ark are found exactly where the Bible tells us that they would be located, upon the mountains of Ararat. That location is 12 miles south of the world-famous Mount Ararat, about 5 kilometers off the main road in a mud flow just below the Kurdish village of Uzungeli.
But we should be there shortly. This is the road leading up to the visitor center for the Ark.
From the visitor center that the Turkish government built for the site in 1987, you can get a good view of the Ark.
Well, there it is, what we came here to see. Noah's Ark.
It appears that part of the left side has fallen out. We're going to have to go down and do some exploration on that.
From this vantage point, you can see several of the features of the formation, such as some of the exposed rib timbers that have eroded out over the years. Here is a closer view. Here is another set of exposed rib timbers on the opposite side. One of the tests we performed at the Ark site was a metal detection survey. This was done by Ron Wyatt's team in the 1980s and showed a distinct pattern of metal rivets that were used to hold the beams of the Ark together. In 1991, Ron found one of these rivets that had fallen out of the formation. It contained a high iron content along with several other metals. On this current survey, we found an iron plate embedded in a petrified beam with two visible rivets still in place. This plate and the rivets gave us a positive metal reading for iron.
What'd you find, Jerry?
Just a rock. A little sample there. I think it'll for somebody to... I'd like to find a nice piece of rivet.
You got one right behind you.
Yeah, but
you can't do anything with it, it's embedded.
Right. I'd like to find one loose.
Over the years, a number of petrified wood specimens have been found. Here is one we located.
Okay, there's the city of Uzengeli. Swing over there and you can see the visitor's center. And right at my feet here is a very large piece of petrified timber. You can see the wood grain and everything. I'm going to zoom in so you can see the texture of it. This looks like wood. And it's stone. Look at that grain. Back off a little bit here. It's coming right out of here where I'm right by the limestone outcropping. See that?
Something.
That's petrified wood.
Yeah.
I mean, look at the grain in that thing.
A number of specimens have been found over the years, but none match this 35-pound laminated deck timber. It was found by Ron in 1987 after spotting it with ground-penetrating radar. More specimens like this can be recovered if we are allowed to perform a limited excavation. One of the most unusual items we came across was this large specimen that appears to be a gigantic piece of petrified bark. It also has carved on it an 8-cross iconographic representation of Noah, his wife, their 3 sons, and their wives, the 8 survivors of the flood.
This is a piece of petrified tree bark, or at least that's what it appears to be, right near Soglik Suyu. You can see the grain in it. It's rather impressive.
Just like you find tree bark on a regular tree.
That's right. Listen, go see if you can point out some of the crosses.
Looks like the big one is right here.
Okay, speak up because of the wind.
It looks like the big one's right here in the middle. And we got one here. And one corresponding on the other side.
Right. Yeah, and there's one right down there, too.
Yeah, another one over here.
There's one further down on your left, close to you. Further down left. It's hard to see from the lichen growing up in the orange. Lichen? No, it's down. Put your hand on it right there. Down a little bit. No, down towards... No, the other way.
This way?
Yeah, right in that area. Yeah, I think that's it.
Probably the best known and recognized artifacts that are associated with Noah's Ark are these large drogue anchor stones. They were most likely used to stabilize the Ark in the rough waters of the deluge. Almost everyone recognizes this monster, which has been photographed hundreds of times over the last 15 years. It is 8 feet tall and is estimated to weigh 3 to 4 tons. While having the iconographic of Noah and his family, it also has carved into it 2 signs of Nimrod when he was still alive. These anchor stones, 13 in all, are scattered throughout the area around the village of Kassan. Here are some clips of Jerry and I examining a few of them.
Here's the anchor stone right there. Here's the part of the hole at the top that breaks off. Yeah, you can see the crosses. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight.
So you got...
Sorry, go ahead. Point them out.
Looks like you got one, two, three, four, five, six, seven.
And the big one in the middle is eight. Markings on both of them as if it's parts of two. Well, I got you here on tape. Why don't you just give me your impressions? Just, you know, whatever you want to say about the last couple of days out on Noah's Ark and Sidewick Suyu and around the Anchor Stone.
Certainly an adventure. I mean, something that the average person is not going to be able to experience. It is somewhat awesome to think that you're right at the exact spot where human history began again after the flood, because that's everybody's roots.
That's right. We all come from Father Noah.
Standing right there.
Something from a few days ago. Are you videotaping this?
I am now.
Okay, good. Okay, what this is it's a stalactite, which is
indeed once a wooden object. In the 1980s, with the cooperation of the Turkish government, Ron and his team were able to do several metal detection surveys, which revealed that the timbers were held together with metal rivets and plates.
Our last trip out there this past June, we found this very impressive rivet. And if you'll notice here, the plate itself is just a little more than a quarter of an inch in thickness. It's approximately 3.5 inches in diameter, the plate itself, and then the shaft of the rivet is roughly an inch to an inch and a quarter in diameter. And if you'll notice here, it was struck while it was hot and flared out the end of the shaft so that it would not slide back through the hole in this washer. And this shows that their abilities to use metal was quite advanced, quite sophisticated. And folks, there are thousands of these rivets on this boat. In fact, at every joint where the wooden structures are held together, they're held together by large metal plates, which are predominantly iron, and then these rivets.
Ground-penetrating radar scans of the formation revealed a huge man-made structure beneath the surface of the formation, which included keels, decks, bulkheads, and all the other parts of an ancient boat. It was during one of these scans that Ron located just below the surface what ended up to be a large piece of a petrified deck timber. On examination, it was seen that it was laminated, that is, it was made up of three separate layers of wood, as you can see in this view.
Do you believe Noah's Ark actually existed? Could the legend that sounds like a fairy tale really become proven fact? Well, the search has been going on since biblical times. And in a moment, you're going to meet some people who are positive they have found the Ark. Now, we know such claims have been made before, but a few months ago, these people came to 2020 with some new and intriguing scientific findings. We followed them to the mountains of eastern Turkey. And what you'll see is a bizarre adventure with a host of unlikely characters. Tom Gerald's story takes many twists and turns.
That's the seductive beauty that brings them here, snow-capped Mount Ararat. The explorers looked for the Ark there since that's the highest point around here. And as the floodwaters receded, presumably that's where it would have landed. But the Bible describes the mountains of Ararat, mountains plural. Is it possible that the Ark came to rest on one of the smaller sister mountains to Ararat?
The boat-shaped site was first found and photographed by a Turkish army captain back in 1959. It was quickly explored and dismissed as a freak of nature. But Wyatt, an amateur archaeologist, rekindled interest in it a few years ago. He brought in Dave Fassel, a marine salvage expert, to assess it. The Doomsday Mountain team brought in some high technology to explore the oldest legend of man. They began scanning their site with a molecular frequency generator. It's a device used by surgeons to pinpoint cancer tumors, and it's been used by Fassel to locate underwater treasure. This time, the molecular frequency generator began to pick up a unique pattern of iron lines beneath the earth.
Okay, bring that one up.
They began placing ribbons along those lines. The finished shape, outlined by the ribbons, was that of a huge ship, the approximate length and width of Noah's Ark, as described in the Bible. The fascinating field of ribbons soon attracted higher academic interest.
That looks like iron. Okay.
Dr. John Baumgartner, a physicist with Los Alamos Laboratories, sent samples back to the lab for analysis and confirmed that the metal they were tracing with the ribbons was indeed iron. With the width and the length known, the only remaining question was depth. By locating the depth of the hull, they could determine if the boat-shaped object had the cargo capacity described in the biblical Ark. To resolve this final issue, Wyatt and Fassel brought geologist Tom Finner to Turkey with his company's heavy-duty subsurface radar equipment. Gear like this located the black box cockpit recorder on the floor of the frozen Potomac River after the Air Florida crash.
Suppose this rock were a foot or 2 feet underground. Would it give you a reading as to where that was? Could you locate it?
Yes, we could.
Is it possible that there will be a moment at which you'll say, this is a man-made object?
The symmetry of the feature suggests it's about... I hope to prove that the underground structure is in fact that of a boat.
It was here, several miles short of the boat-shaped site, that a waiting game began for Finner and the others. The party needed a final go-ahead from the Turkish government to complete their probe of Doomsday Mountain.
Yes. Anyway, we're going to hang in like smell on a skunk till they have to lay up. Get this done.
And then like the smell and the skunk. The Turkish government stopped the exploration. What now?
Since we were there, Barbara, things have cooled down, and they've sent their own team of scientists in to take a look at this site. It's a very fascinating location.
In August 1985, he receives the necessary permits and clearance to perform the radar examinations. At long last, they perform the scan, and the results are stunning. Before their very eyes, the machine tells the story of what lies beneath the surface of the object. There are massive keelsons, deck timbers, open chambers, gunnels, and other various configurations which Ron and other specialists believe identifies the object as the remains of an ancient man-made ship.
Indeed, there is something beneath that rock besides rock. A radar device developed by Geophysical Survey Systems in Hudson was used on the mountain. The device called SIR is used by energy exploration companies to analyze what's below the Earth's surface. According to SIR, something man-made is under Mount Aridog.
This data does not represent natural geology. It's a man-made structure. These reflections are occurring very periodic, too periodic to be random natural type interfaces.
Since Ron's initial work, a number of other artifacts have been found by himself and various others who have worked at the site. As to the anchor stones, 13 in total have been found. is approximately the same size, although some of them have been broken over the years. Each has the very distinctive Vopo at the top. Most have crosses carved on them, although two of the stones have been found with no inscriptions whatsoever. Numerous pieces of petrified wood have been found in and around the site, such as these samples. In 1998, while surveying the site with other scientists, Dr. William Shea of the Biblical Research Institute found a pottery shard about 10 meters from the western side of the formation. On one side is painted the picture of a man releasing two birds. On the other side is etched a picture of a man with a hammer in his hand driving a spike or nail. The man is wearing some type of a headdress. Across the front of the headdress, the name Noah is written in Proto-Sinaitic text. This is the first piece of hard evidence that directly ties any ark site to the biblical character Noah.
What we actually have found is physical evidence that this is a boat. Whether or not it's Noah's Ark is up to the people that review the material. That's up to them to decide on that. My personal feeling is that it is Noah's Ark.
Since Ron's death in August 1999, several of his associates have continued his work. In February 2000, the political situation in eastern Turkey improved dramatically. Since that time, it has been possible to work in relative safety in the area. A number of other objects and inscriptions have been recently found that are believed to be associated with the Ark. These are currently being analyzed. In Egypt, on the Gulf of Aqaba, Ron gazed across the water with anguish for many years. Based on his finding of chariot remains at Nuweiba, he knew in 1978 that Mount Sinai was in Saudi Arabia. Mount Sinai, the place where the law of God was given, written by God's own finger on tables of stone. After viewing maps of this part of Saudi Arabia, Ron felt that a mountain named Jebel al-Laz was the most likely candidate to be the true Mount Sinai. Over the next 5 years, Ron applied for a visa to enter Saudi Arabia, but was turned down time and time again. Finally, in 1984, Ron and his two sons traveled to Jordan, slipped across the Saudi border, and traveled to the site to search for evidence. They found the mountain along with numerous pieces of evidence indicating that Ron's belief was accurate. Jebel al-Laz was the mountain of God mentioned in the book of Exodus. They took video and photographs of this evidence and prepared to leave Saudi through Jordan the same way they entered. But just short of the border, they were spotted by Saudi authorities and arrested. It took 78 days for them to convince the Saudis that they were just American explorers and not Israeli spies. They were then released, but all of their film and videotape was confiscated.
Three weary Americans came home Monday night. Ronald Wyatt and his sons Daniel and Ronald Jr. returned in Nashville at the end of an amateur archaeology expedition that landed them in a Saudi Arabian jail. They entered Saudi Arabia illegally, searching for the site of the biblical Mount Sinai. Ronald Wyatt and his sons are with us in the studios of our Nashville affiliate WTVF to tell us all about it. Gentlemen, good morning.
Morning. Mr. Wyatt, you there in the middle, yes. Your sons on either side. Why did you, I didn't know that Mount Sinai was in Saudi Arabian territory. Why did you think it was?
We found some chariot parts that looked like the chariots found in King Tut's tomb in the Gulf of Aqaba, west of this Jebel el-Lawz. We found these at depths from 60 feet out to 200 feet and over a stretch of about a mile and a half. And we believe that that was the crossing site. And so in the biblical narrative, they arrived at Mount Sinai after crossing the Red Sea. The language in the Bible indicates that they stayed in a mountain, enclosed in a mountain. So an aerial map showed that this Jebel el-Lawz had a large valley enclosed in the rim of an ancient volcano. It was about 5,000 acres in there. We felt this was the place. And in Exodus 24:4 and in Leviticus 6:28, 11:33 and 15:12, it tells of some artifacts that were to be found. There was to be 12 pillars of stone and an altar and some pottery. And so this is why we looked at that particular mountain.
It was not until 1992 that Ron Wyatt was able to find someone that lived in Saudi to go to the site and document it again for him. Now we can see this majestic mountain where God's own presence rested. Jebel el-Lawz in northwest Saudi Arabia. Here's the documentation.
This process caused the layering effect. Most of the formations Ron saw were unrecognizable, as they had collapsed in upon themselves over the centuries. But the solid structures, such as walls, statues, and worship symbols, were in a remarkably good state of preservation. Ron was able to locate the outer wall of the city, and following this, he soon found himself looking into the main part of Gomorrah. But before he entered in, he noticed on a high prominence, about 100 meters from what appeared to be the gate of the city, an amazingly distinct formation. It clearly bore the shape of a sphinx. The location of this formation is significant because it was a practice of the Canaanite people of this period to place statues of their gods outside of their cities as a form of protection.
Welcome. We're here at the site of what we believe is Gomorrah, near the Dead Sea, and just a little further south from here is Masada. But we found this very distinct formation up on a raised area right outside this city wall here, and I wanted to show you a few distinct features about it. Other than the fact that it stands out from everything else and is sitting outside the city wall, it's made from ash. You see, it just crumbles when I rub it with my finger.
Keep doing that, Bill.
You can see the layering in this formation, and this is all ash. It's just. But notice also the coloring is it's white towards the bottom, and as you go to the top, it gets darker. Also, if you look across the bottom here, you can see that this formation is not even a part of what we're standing on. There's actually a built-up platform right here, and then this was actually at some point sat on top of it. So there's no way that this could have been formed by water runoff or sedimentation. This is not a natural formation. It's a man-made formation of some type, and if you walk around the thing, you can see that it has very much of a body, a neck, and a head, although the details of the features have worn off over the centuries. But it's still a very distinctive feature, and it was quite common in these Canaanite cities for them to place their deities and worship figures outside the city as a form of protection.
Within the city, Ron also found this amazing structure, which appears to be the remains of a very large building, perhaps a palace. It is about 50 feet in height and was found to have a moat completely surrounding it. Notice the definite roofline and the squared corners that still remain. Adjacent to the city was a raised platform with three formations on it. When viewed from the top of Masada, it appeared to resemble a worship complex. It is one of the highest areas within the city and this is consistent with these ancient people placing their worship areas on a raised platform. A building that was probably the remains of a temple is the largest formation on the platform. There's also a definite sphinx-shaped formation that is about 25 feet in height. The last formation resembles a ziggurat, that is a step pyramid, which is about 30 feet in height. Compare this to a similar pyramid found in Egypt near Cairo.
So what we're looking at is we're at this area in what we believe is Gomorrah, and we found this ashen remains of some kind of building. We're not sure what it is, and we were wondering how we could prove that it was a building. Here we see two stones. 99% of this is ash, but we found these two stones that have been burnt and have probably fallen from a higher part of this building. And this proves that at one point this building was made from stone. Now, the way you can tell it's burnt is if you look right here, when this stone fell, it chipped or broke. And here you can see a burn ring right here in the stone. And here you see the lighter actual color of the rock before it was burned, because this was broken off and wasn't burned. So here we see more evidence of the fact that this building was once made of stone, but now is ash, and that it was burnt at very high temperatures.
While searching for conclusive proof that would convince others that these were the remains of the cities of the plain, Ron began to find round balls of a yellow material within the ash that had the smell of sulfur. Could this be the brimstone mentioned in the Bible story? He found this sulfur everywhere and collected numerous samples. Once back in the United States, Ron took these samples to Galbraith Labs in Knoxville, Tennessee. It was found that this material was not only sulfur, but it was quite unique. Any good book on geology will tell you that native sulfur, that is, sulfur as it appears in nature, is always found in crystalline form. The purity varies from 40 to 60%. Samples from Ron's sites have tested up to 98% in purity, and they're not in crystalline form, but in a powdered form. Many of the samples have reddish-brown rings around the perimeter. This is a sulfur compound that is formed when burning molten sulfur is cooled very quickly. This is evidence that these samples were once on fire. We have since shown this sulfur to experts, and they all agree that they are completely unique. In fact, Stetson University near Orlando, Florida, which owns the second largest privately held mineral collection in the world, asked us to donate a sample to them because they had no specimen like it at all. A chief geologist at Virginia Tech University stated that he had never seen sulfur so finely grained. When he showed it to a colleague and told him the sample came from the Dead Sea area, the other geologist commented, "Could this be the fiery brimstone from the Holy Land?" Ron explains.
Now, the Bible tells us that it rained fire and brimstone upon the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, what you see in front of you here is the results of large and small, well, varying sized chunks of sulfur, burning sulfur, that have hit. And what we find here is that God rained this burning sulfur down upon this city, and rain is a perfect description of it. It landed just in the pattern that rain would fall. And the stuff, of course, the accumulative heat of all of this upon the city set the entire thing ablaze. The flashpoint of every material there, metal, stone, of course the people, and everything burned. And this sulfur continued to burn, and it vitrified the material around it. After it had burned it all up, sealed itself off from the oxygen, and then of course smothered itself out. And in each of these little crystalline capsules here is a varying size chunk of sulfur. And there are millions of these in these ashes that we have here. Now, some of them we have cracked open so you can see the sulfur inside, and others we have left intact. But there are millions of these here. So this shows that God indeed rained fire and brimstone upon these cities. And if you'll look in your dictionary, under brimstone, you'll find that it is sulfur.
Ron decided to see what would happen when this sulfur was ignited. He performed his own small test at home with some of the sulfur from one of the capsules and a spoon. The purplish flame is indicative of the intense heat which prevented him from holding the spoon as it burned. He later discovered that his spoon had a hole in it from the fire. Then he placed a small piece of the ash material in a spoon and attempted to burn it, but it wouldn't burn at all. It was already completely consumed by fire, and nothing was left to ignite. In 1978, while in Jerusalem, Ron Wyatt was walking outside the old city near Calvary Escarpment when he met a man who worked with the Israeli Department of Antiquities. As they walked along discussing Roman antiquities, Ron had an experience that had never happened to him before. His left hand suddenly moved out from his side and pointed to a spot at the base of the escarpment wall. As this happened, he found himself saying, "That's Jeremiah's grotto. And the Ark of the Covenant is in there." Up until this point, Ron had never thought about finding the Ark of the Covenant. He had never researched the subject, much less thought about the possibility of excavating for it. As his mind was reeling, considering the possibility, he was astonished to hear his companion say, "That's wonderful. We'll not only furnish you the permit, we'll put you up in a place to stay, have your laundry done, and furnish your meals." But Ron was perplexed. The only reason he was in Jerusalem was because he had gotten severely sunburned while diving for chariot parts in the Red Sea, and had come back to wait his flight back home. He explained to the man from the Antiquities Department that he was due back at work, so he would have to go home and return later. That would give him time to do some research to figure out whether or not the Ark of the Covenant could even be in that location. Beginning that next year, Ron came back time and time again with his sons, Danny and Ronnie, and dug throughout the cave system under the Calvary Escarpment, having little idea where he was even supposed to look. As they excavated down the escarpment wall in the area where his hand had pointed, they uncovered three cutouts in the cliff face that were consistent with cutouts used by the Romans to hold signs, a rough equivalent to our billboard signs today. The signs detailed the crimes for which the criminals were being executed. Digging down further, they discovered the wall of a first century building that they believed was a church, as it contained an altar. In front of that altar was a 14-inch square hole in the bedrock, with three other similar holes out in front of it. These were the type of holes used to hold crosses upright, a form of Roman execution. The single cross hole was filled with a stone plug and was unusual in that it had a large crack in it. Within the crack was a dark brown substance that looked like dried blood. However, Ron did not understand the significance of this at the time. Finally, in January of 1982, after digging in the cave system for 3 years, Ron discovered a tunnel that led into a chamber, which contained a gold table and several other articles which he believed to be from the First Temple. Then, further back, he saw the top of a stone case that appeared to be the correct size to contain the Ark of the Covenant. In the ceiling of the chamber, directly above the left side of the stone case, Ron noticed a large crack. He also noticed that the top of the stone case was broken,
creating an opening in the top of the case. And splashed around that opening in the top was the same brown substance that Ron had seen by the cross hole. Realizing what he had found, Ron, overwhelmed with emotion, passed out and lay in that chamber for 45 minutes. He knew what was in that case, but now what? He attempted to photograph it with a Polaroid camera, a 35mm camera, and video. In every case, the images were a whiteout. Ron returned home to work until he could afford to return. In May, he borrowed a colonoscope and went back into the chamber, drilling a small hole through